The Bambu Labs X1 and its stripped-down version, the P1P, are without a doubt the fastest out-of-the-box 3D printers at the moment. But they have a problem. They're actually printing too fast, leaving you with inconsistent surface quality and, even worse, bad strength. We'll talk about why speed isn't everything, how to approach this problem, and how to fix it using slicer settings and even custom high-flow nozzles. Let's find out more. Guten Tag, everybody. I'm Stefan and welcome to CNC Kitchen. This video is sponsored by Protolabs, your reliable prototyping and production partner. Check them out using the link below. Even if you don't own a Bambu Lab printer, you might have already stumbled over a print where you have matte surfaces on one height and shiny ones on another. This has been becoming a more and more common problem when we try to print faster and faster. We have now reached the point where printers, even with a 0.4mm nozzle, run faster than their hotends are capable of melting the plastic that you want to extrude. If we take this benchy right here and compare glossy and matte surfaces to the flow visualization, so how much material is extruded per second, we can see that they perfectly correlate. Glossy sections are printed with a low flow rate and matte ones significantly faster. This behavior is not only something you can use for artistic purposes, but it's also an indication that a 3D printer is working just at its melting limit. I've been using my Bambu Labs X1 and P1P quite a bit ever since I got them, and very regularly noticed that behavior on my parts, and even others messaged me about this problem. Most of the time I don't care a lot about aesthetics, but I more than once also noticed something different, and in my opinion even more serious. If I printed parts with the standard profiles and really pushed the machine to its limits, the parts sometimes were severely weaker than I expected. The first time this happened was when printing samples for my 3D print versus wood strength video, where the first hooks printed in PETG broke way earlier than expected. After slowing the print down quite significantly, I was able to reach a standard strength again. The other case was quite recently when I tuned in a profile for printing my Red Rig V3 parts from Extruder ASA. I usually start with the default profiles, print a part or two, check the surface quality, and then try to break them. With Bambu Labs' default profile and the temperature already set to the upper range of the recommendations, the layer adhesion wasn't great. Instead of tuning down the speeds within the slicer, I usually go into the material settings and reduce the flow limits step by step until I don't see any under extrusion anymore and layer adhesion also looks good. And again, tuning down the flow rate and therefore effectively lowering speeds solved my strength problems. So after years of trying to get our printers to move faster and faster with reasonable print quality, we came to the point where they go so fast that regular hotends can't keep up with the speeds anymore. On more open machines, you'd now install a high-flow hotend like a E3D Volcano, which has a longer melt zone which gives the material more time to get liquid. Bambu Labs of course thought about this and designed a hotend that looks quite comparable in length to a Volcano hotend. Unfortunately, even these longer hotends can only give you a maximum reliable melt rate of around 15 to 20 cubic millimeters a second, and with the standard profile, you are already in the range of 25 cubic millimeters a second when printing the infill. The slicer combats that by limiting the maximum flow rate artificially to, for example, 12 cubic millimeters a second for generic PLA and 21 cubic millimeters for their own, probably custom PLA. You can also increase melting capability by rising the temperature, and this is exactly what Bambu Labs does in many of their profiles, where they set the extrusion temperatures uncomfortably high for many materials. So if the hotend of the X1 or P1P is already in Volcano length, let's change the nozzle because we have seen that Bontech's CHT nozzle that splits the filament up and heats it from the inside can significantly increase flow. Well, that's unfortunately not possible because due to Bambu Labs' proprietary hotend, the nozzle is crimped into the heater block, and when you want to switch between nozzle diameters, you need to replace the whole hotend and heatsink assembly, and using custom nozzles is impossible. Yet, Aliexpress to the rescue. At the end of last year, I saw the first third-party replacement parts and accessories for the Bambu Labs printers popping up on Aliexpress, and one of them is a replacement hotend with changeable nozzles too, which I put a link down in the description. I honestly don't see the real point in it because it costs almost as much as a complete assembly from Bambu Labs and doesn't even come with a fan, heating element and thermistor. Yet, it has a replaceable nozzle with a standard M6 thread. Of course, I ordered one because I wanted to put one of Bontech's CHT nozzles in there. In order to install it, you need to exchange all of the electronic components from a Bambu Labs Hotend, but then it's plug and play. Well, kind of, because the standard nozzles that the replacement Hotend uses are 1.9 mm shorter than the regular V6 ones, and this causes some issues on the printer. If you, for example, install a CHT nozzle in the Hotend, the X one will notice that the Hotend is longer, which you can ignore, but it will bend the nozzle wiper quite a bit more. This can also be fixed by printing a shorter wiper. But what can't be fixed is that the part cooling fan now blows more on the nozzle than on the part, which I try to visualize with some smoke and a line laser. Oh, and if you value the work I put into these videos, leave a like and make sure that you're subscribed. Even though some people have attempted to shorten the heat break to get the length closer to stock, I wanted to do it the proper way and build my own high flow nozzle with one of the copper slugs which you find in many knockoff CHT nozzles that work just as well as Bontech's complex machined nozzles. So I made a CAD model and drawing and prepared myself to put my mini lathe to work once again. Yet there are sometimes parts where you don't have the suitable manufacturing process in-house, or you need a part quickly but don't have the time to manufacture it yourself. In situations like this, you need to check out today's video sponsor Protolabs. Protolabs is fast, easy to use, and more than just a generic prototyping service. When you upload your CAD file on their website and choose the manufacturing process and material, your design is automatically checked for manufacturability in their intuitive online tool. Yet what makes or breaks a good and cost-effective part is choosing the right manufacturing process and material. Here is where the experts from Protolabs come into play. They have years of experience in figuring out if your part should be conventionally machined, 3D printed, or even injection molded. They work closely on your side to ensure that you get a quote within hours and that you'll get your parts fast, in the best quality, and cost effective. Protolabs have a vast portfolio of manufacturing technologies in-house that enables them to satisfy all of your requirements, from only one part to even thousands. Their super efficient processes allow them to deliver finished prototypes within days, so you can finish your projects faster and stay ahead of the competition. If you want to learn more about Protolabs services, check them out using the link below. Thanks to Protolabs for sponsoring this video. So I was just about to start machining my own Bambu Labs CHT nozzle when Aliexpress struck again, because a seller actually made a CHT high flow nozzle perfectly fitting the third party replacement Hotend. They weren't as cheap as the flood of other nozzles you can get on the platform, but they do look pretty. Yet more importantly, how do they perform, and are they able to solve the high speed printing problems the Bambu Labs printers have? Let's start with a meandering extrusion test. This is a single wall part that's printed in vase mode. The higher we go, the faster we'll print. In the past, I created these manually by using custom G-code commands, but I recently learned that Allcut Slicer, which is a derivative of Bambu Slicer, has a set of calibration prints integrated, and this flow test is one of them. I started with a stock 0.4 mm Bambu Hotend as a reference. The test starts at 5 cubic millimeters a second and then increases the flow rate by 1 cubic millimeters a second every millimeter. I used voxel PLA printed at 220 degree Hotend temperature. I had to stop the first test at around 30 cubic millimeters a second when there was severe under extrusion. The final speed I was able to achieve, which still looked good, was 23 cubic millimeters a second. Next, I switched out the Hotend and tested the third party replacement with their stock hardened steel nozzle. It performed basically the same, and I spotted the first holes in the outer wall at 24 cubic millimeters a second. So not really an improvement over the stock nozzle. Then I switched the nozzle to the custom short CHT one from Aliexpress. With this one, I was able to get all the way up to 50 cubic millimeters a second without a print fail, yet the first extrusion problems started already at 34 cubic millimeters a second, which is still almost 50% more flow capability than the stock configuration, which is impressive. For completeness, I also tested a genuine Bontech CHT, which performed pretty much the same with the first holes in the hull at 32 cubic millimeters a second. I first thought Bontech CHT was a no-go due to its length, but after all of my tests with a shortened wiper, I didn't notice any differences to a proper length nozzle, and even cooling performance didn't look worse. Unfortunately, both CHT nozzles didn't get rid of the transition from shiny to matte that starts right around at 10 cubic millimeters a second extrusion rate, and I think your only option here is to raise the temperatures. With the mat surfaces starting at the same height, does this also mean that the high flow nozzles won't improve part strength for high speed prints? For that, I printed a ton of layer adhesion samples at extrusion rates of 5, 12, 20, and 28 cubic millimeters a second. Just that you get an idea how flow rate translates to speed. At 0.2mm layers and a 0.4mm nozzle, 5 cubic millimeters a second are extruded at 60mm a second speed. 12 cubic millimeters a second is 140mm a second speed. 20 cubic millimeters a second is 240mm a second, and 28 cubic millimeters a second is around 330mm a second. These are vertically printed coupons that I'll pull apart on my DIY universal test machine, and I expected that slow printing equals strong parts and fast printing equals weak. Unfortunately, it wasn't that easy. First, even though you set your printer speed to ridiculously fast values, it needs to accelerate and then decelerate again, and this takes some distance. Since the test section of my samples is only 6mm in diameter, there isn't a lot of time to get to speed and decelerate again, so I had to use ridiculously high acceleration values of 13,000mm per second squared, and even then only part of the sample is really printed at these high speeds. But for the moment, this was my only idea to test the speed behavior in kind of a scientific way. If you have other ideas, please let me know in the comments. Another factor I wanted to rule out is layer time. So if I would have printed the same amount of coupons in each print, the slow jobs would have taken way longer than the faster ones, giving the parts more time to cool down and therefore potentially affecting layer strength this way. So I reduced the number of samples on the slower prints so that each job only ran a good hour. These samples were also printed in voxel PLA at 220 degrees Celsius, but be aware that other materials might behave very differently, which means that the effect we'll see might be more or less prominent. For each speed, I tested 4 samples printed with a stock Bambu Lab hotend and another 4 using the CHT nozzle. The samples printed with the original hotend and nozzle at 5 cubic millimeters a second failed at 34 megapascals, at 12 cubic millimeters a second at 36 megapascals, and then they slowly started dropping to 33 and 31 megapascals. From everything that I subjectively felt in the past, I expected a way bigger drop off, but I think that generic layer adhesion samples are not the perfect method to show this effect. But the big question is if the CHT nozzle improved the layer adhesion or rather lowered the drop-off. And yes, it actually did. Using the custom high-flow nozzle, the layer adhesion strength stayed between 35 and 37 megapascals on average and also was generally a slight bit higher. And I also kind of confirmed this when printing the red rig parts with the two different nozzles. The parts printed at high speed with the CHT nozzle felt noticeably stronger and didn't just break between the layers. So if you want to squeeze every bit of performance out of your machine, investing in a replacement hotend and installing either a Bontech or custom Aliexpress CHT nozzle in it might be worth trying. In the end, I think I was able to show that the race for maximum speed has its limits, and with great speeds also comes great problems. And this is not only how to compensate for vibrations of the print head. Printing fast doesn't only require a good motion system, but also a hotend that's able to consistently melt materials at these speeds. And even though Bambu Lab did a tremendous job of creating a fast motion system, if you want to go to its limits, the hotend will be the limiting factor, and this will become even more severe if you want to print with bigger diameter nozzles. Speed isn't everything, and if you want to print more than just hundreds of benchies, a well-tuned printer system might be better than one that's primarily horribly fast. For mechanically loaded parts, you often won't be going all the way to what the maximum advertised speeds of the machines are, because speeds need to be balanced with the extrusion capability. So if you also want strong parts from a X1 or P1P, be aware of this and maybe lower the maximum extrusion rate until you're happy with the results. Lower part cooling because the Bambu Labs profile used this even for ABS and ASA, which does make nicer looking prints but hurts layer adhesion. If your material can cope with it, rising temperatures by 10, 20 or even 30 degrees Celsius is another option to improve melting performance and therefore make sure that your parts come out strong with all of the downsides with higher temperatures. And if you want to slightly mod your machine, I think it can be well worth investing in the third party hotend and some CHT nozzles. Leave a like if you found this helpful and let me know if you ever experienced that your parts suffered in strength or quality when printing fast. Thanks for watching, everyone. I hope you found this video interesting. If you want to support my work, head over to Patreon or become a YouTube member. Also, check out the other videos in my library. I hope to see you in the next one. Auf Wiedersehen and goodbye. Printing my rhetoric V3.